je l'ai vu après tout, la première fois dans un hôtel à Toronto, lorsqu'on s'est rencontrés pour la première fois, après de multiples palabres au téléphone ou par lettre pour prendre notre premier rendez-vous. Je l'ai rencontré, il faisait 30 degrés à l'extérieur, il faisait vraiment très chaud. Il était en manteau, il avait ses casquettes, des écharpes, des gants, enfin tout un accoutrement qui semblait extravagant et qui en réalité correspondait exactement à la protection qu'il avait besoin, dont il avait besoin vis-à-vis du monde extérieur pour se protéger de ce qui, en fait, il est mort, des problèmes de germination, des problèmes de tension sanguine. Donc, bien entendu, si vous voulez, la première vision qu'on pouvait avoir de quelqu'un de ce genre était très, très étonnante. On ne peut pas ne pas être saisi devant quelqu'un qui, avec cet air quasiment clochardesque. Selon, il entrait dans votre chambre, à l'hôtel, et puis il est resté pendant 18 heures d'affilée. Aucun souci extérieur, aucun souci de la nourriture, quoi que ce soit, ne venait troubler en fait le rapport qu'on est en train d'établir. Et la seconde chose qui vous a frappé, c'était l'humour, c'était l'extraordinaire capacité de s'amuser et de lancer des idées qui étaient stimulantes, à la fois par leur profondeur et par leur drôlerie. Et donc, si vous voulez, cette manière un petit peu bizarre, qui était la première chose que vous saisissiez et qui ne durait que cet instant de la première rencontre. Après, c'était fini. Ça disparaissait très rapidement pour faire place à l'homme réel qu'il était et qui était, en fait, dans lequel rien chez lui ne cherchait à choquer. C'était simplement lui-même qui cherchait à exprimer.
Begin, let me ask straight out, are there any off-limit areas?
I certainly can't think of any, apart from music, of course.
Well, Mr. Gould, I don't want to go back on my word. I realize that your participation in this interview was never contractually confirmed, but I had rather assumed that we'd spend the bulk of the interview on music-related matters. Do you think it's essential?
I mean, my own personal philosophy of interviewing, and I've done quite a bit of it on the air, as perhaps you know, is that the most illuminating disclosures usually derive from areas only indirectly related to the interviewee's line of work.
For example?
Well, for example, in the course of preparing radio documentaries, I've interviewed a theologian about technology, a surveyor about William James, and a housewife about acquisitiveness in the art market.
But surely you've interviewed musicians about music?
Well, yes, I have, on occasion, but only in order to put them at ease in front of the mic. But it's been far more instructive to talk with Leopold Stokowski about the prospect for interplanetary travel, which is, I'm sure you'll agree.
Let me put it this way. Is there a subject you particularly like to discuss?
What about native rights in Alaska?
Well, I must confess I had a rather more conventional line of attack, so to speak, in mind, Mr. Gould. As I'm sure you're aware, the virtually obligatory question in regard to your career is the controversy you created by giving up live concert performance at the age of 32 and choosing to communicate only through the media. I do feel we must at least touch on it.
As far as I'm concerned, it primarily involves moral rather than musical considerations. In any case, be my guest.
Now, you've been quoted as saying that your involvement with recording, with media in general, indeed, represents the future.
That's correct.
And that conversely, the concert hall, the recital stage, the opera house, or whatever, represent the past, an aspect of your own past in particular, perhaps, as well as, in more general terms, music's past.
That's true.
I hope you'll forgive me for saying that these ideas are only partly justified. Also, I feel that you, Mr. Gould, have foregone the privilege that is rightfully yours of communicating with an audience.
From a power base?
From a setting in which the naked fact of your humanity is unedited and unadorned.
Couldn't I at least be allowed to display the tuxedoed fallacy, perhaps?
Please, Mr. Gould, I don't feel we should allow this conversation to degenerate. I've tried to pose the question in all candor and...
Well then, I'll try and answer likewise. To me, the ideal audience-to-artist relationship is a one-to-zero relationship. That's where the moral objection comes in.
Run that by me again?
First, I'm not at all happy with words like public and artist. I'm not happy with the hierarchical implications of that kind of terminology. The artist should be granted anonymity. He should be permitted to operate in secret, as it were, unconcerned with, or better still, unaware of the presumed demands of the marketplace, which demands, given sufficient indifference on the part of a sufficient number of artists, will simply disappear. Given that disappearance, the artist will then abandon his false sense of public responsibility, and his audience, or public, will relinquish its role of servile dependency.
And never the twain shall meet.
No, they'll make contact, but on a much more meaningful level.
Well, Mr. Gould, I'm well aware that this sort of idealistic role-swapping has a certain rhetorical flourish. The creative audience concept, to which you've devoted a lot of interview space elsewhere, has a kind of McLuhan-esque fascination, but yet you conveniently forget that the artist, however hermetic his lifestyle, is still, in effect, an autocratic figure. He's still, however benevolently, a social dictator. And his public, however generously enfranchised by electronic options, is still on the receiving end of the experience. And all your neo-medieval anonymity quest on behalf of the artist as zero and all your vertical pan-culturalism on behalf of his public isn't going to change that. May I speak now? Of course, I didn't mean to get carried away, but I do feel strongly about the...